All right, so we are flying. We're flying the AR wing with Arduplane. I've updated it to 4.0.9, which is the current official, whatever, stable release. I was playing around with 4.1 beta, but there's apparently an issue with my GPS. The GPS that I have in this particular wing is limited to...
Cruise.
Let me go to cruise mode.
Cruise flight mode.
So it'll hold my altitude for me while I talk to you guys. But yeah, the GPS that I have in this particular airplane is the HGLRC, is the M8030 chip, which is limited to a baud rate of 115,200 bits per second. I think that's right, 115,200. But being that it's limited to that baud rate, it's not going to work with the way 4.1 is set up right now. It tries to set up the GPS for a higher bit rate than that. A friend of mine who does some development work for Arduplane did try to help me out with that earlier this afternoon or this evening as I was getting ready to fly. And we were able to get the GPS talking to Arduplane, but it still wouldn't lock. It wouldn't arm, rather, once I had a good lock and everything. It was failing the arm check, the pre-arm check. And I'm not 100% sure why. I won't pretend to understand all that stuff. But I do know that he said they should be able to get it squared away pretty soon in the next few days or something. So I expect it to work in the future. Worst case, I'll just swap the GPS out for a better one that can handle a higher baud rate. But that's why we're on 4.0.9 right now, which is fine. It's the latest stable release anyway. But beyond that, I don't really have any particular plans for flying other than just to get the thing out and fly it. It's been a little while since I've had this one out or flown anything with Arduplane for that matter. And if you watched my previous video, you might notice I'm kind of following that same little path out to 2 miles where I flew the other airplanes recently. But I'm not going to turn back at 2 miles. I'm going to go ahead and climb up to, I don't know, around 350, 375 or so. We'll stay below 400. But I want to climb a bit and just kind of head out this way. We'll stop there. I'm not sure how well it's going to come out on the recording, but my takeoff went much, much, much smoother with this airplane, better than it ever has for me previously. And again, this is the Sonic Model AR Wing Pro that I've always had trouble launching it. I've actually kind of put it into the ground once for sure, maybe two or three times. I don't really remember. I know it hit the ground once, but it didn't really cause any damage. It's a pretty tough little wing. But I've never been really consistently good at launching the thing. What I did this time, I used the takeoff flight mode like I usually do in Arduplane. But I did an overhead and backwards throw. The two-handed, just kind of throw it backwards over your head. And it just flew right away. It was very simple. So that is going to be how I launch this one from here on out. I just wanted to point that out because I know a lot of people have complained about how hard this one is to launch with a normal kind of sidearm throw, which is how I've always launched this one. It's the only way I've ever been consistently good at launching wings, but this one just doesn't like it. But that overhead backwards throw, just kind of two-handed and throw it backwards over your head, and it just flew straight away. Now, obviously, it's in the takeoff mode. It's going to level itself and climb out at a set, you know, rate and everything. With some power already on and all, but it works. So that's what I'll be doing in the future. And I am flying it in the heaviest configuration right now. I have the 4S3P 18650 pack from Cluosi. It's the one that I flew a couple of times before. And it works well in this little wing. I like it. But I don't know. I guess we're just going to maybe head out to the river and then maybe head back home. It is, I mean, the sun has already set. It's 7:38 right now. But, you know, I don't want it to go get dark on me before I can land. Although I do have the Caddx Retail in here, which is a reasonably good camera for a low light. But, so we're just over 4 miles now. And I am flying with a 915 megahertz Dragonlink receiver, the V3. And like I said, the RSSI has been sitting on like in the low 50s since I took off, low to mid 50s. But that is to be expected with this firmware. And I was kind of watching it. The airplane kind of dipped, lost a little bit of altitude there as we got over the water. The air over the river out here is usually cooler, based on what I've been told from full-scale pilots that fly the area, that you do get a little bit of sink over the river. I was kind of noticing that. But it climbed right back above it, right back to where we were. But yeah, everything's good. Video's good. Radio link is good. Or do planes flying good? I guess we might want to stay back at least on the our side of the river. You know, flying a new firmware and everything, just in case something does go awry. Which I don't expect it to, but I would like to at least better my chances of getting my airplane back should it happen. So we'll just kind of come back and stay a little bit closer to home. Or at least out over the open fields in this area where I can drive to if I should need to. But again, that's just kind of me being cautious, overly cautious, perhaps. But yeah, it flies every bit as good as I remember. But my reason for wanting to get back into Arduplane, fly it a little bit more. For one, I'm just barely getting started in Arduplane. It can do so much more than I've done with it myself. I'll never use it to its full potential. It can do things that I have no interest in. You know, a lot of professional applications and stuff like that. But I do want to try out an airspeed sensor. And Henry, he's the same guy that I mentioned before that was helping me out with Arduplane earlier today. He has a contact at a company called...
90%.
Okay. That's Yahoo telemetry script, by the way, doing those call-outs. It's the first time using that as well. We'll talk about that more in a minute. But before I lose track, what I was saying, Henry, the guy that was helping me out with Arduplane earlier today, has a contact at a company called Kiotek. Q-I-O-T-E-K. I guess that's how you pronounce it, Kiotek. But they make a nice I2C interface digital airspeed sensor. And he talked to his contact, and they're going to send me one to try out. But it needs version 4.1 or later to be supported, or they also have some custom builds you can run right now, some stable builds if you want to. But I was hoping to just move up to 4.1 beta, which is, it's still in beta stage right now, but it's flyable. There's a number of people using it already. Once we get the GPS issue squared away, or I just swap the GPS out for one that will support a higher bit rate, then I'll be able to use it as well. But once those airspeed sensors arrive, I need to be able to have that supported on the airplane. Because right now, you notice I'm showing my ground speed and airspeed over on the left-hand side of my OSD. And on the lower right corner, I have the wind speed, direction and speed showing on the OSD. That's all calculated synthetically, I think is the term Arduplane uses. Ardupilot, rather. It's just estimated based on the way the airplane's flying and crabbing to hold its course, and with this GPS and everything, it does a fairly good job of estimating the airspeed, the wind speed. But I'll have an actual hardware airspeed sensor in the airplane once I get that. Something else I was going to talk about. Oh yeah, the Yahoo telemetry script. I have it running on my radio right now. It's the first time using it. To get that working, was I am still using the Dragonlink relay, but to get the Mavlink telemetry back into the radio for Yahoo, I'm using a Heltec ESP32 Wi-Fi module, which is mounted up on the wall with my Dragonlink transmitter, and it takes the data from the Dragonlink. And I actually made my turn a little sooner than I thought. I thought I was following the roadway there, but the roadway is actually further west. I guess we could just shoot across the woods here at an angle and kind of intercept the roadway out here. Kind of at these next open fields where we're going to head out to. But anyway, I have the Mavlink telemetry coming down across the radio modem that's built into the Dragonlink. And the ESP32 on the wall mounted with the transmitter, it's running a MAV2 pass-through and converting that telemetry to free sky telemetry and pushing that back through the 2.4 gigahertz receiver across the relay link to my radio. So I have Yahoo telemetry script working, and it's also pushing out the data over UDP on my local area network. It's connected to the Wi-Fi router that's in my shed, and the PC that I'm actually recording all this is with. You see I have telemetry over there on the Q ground control window. That telemetry is coming from the same little Heltec module via Wi-Fi. The little module logs on to my Wi-Fi network and sends telemetry out via UDP. So any device on my local area network, be it in the shed or back in the house, anywhere on my network here at home, can connect and run Mission Planner or Q ground control, or there's a number of mobile apps that can utilize it. If I wanted to use my phone, I can do that. So it's a pretty neat little setup. And just kind of getting full potential out of it, what you can do with the telemetry. So we're just kind of moving forward a little bit with Arduplane, getting into some of the more, I guess you could say, advanced topics, features, a little bit beyond the basics. Yeah, I'm quite happy with the wing, with everything basically. And I'm noticing we're sitting around 100 milliamp hours per, I think that's kilometer. I don't think that's per mile, I think that's kilometer, but I will, or I'm sure someone will correct me if I'm wrong on that. If I remember, I'll put a note on screen what that efficiency number is. But I do remember it staying in the low 100s, which is a pretty efficient setup, especially carrying this big battery. I have, like I said, it's a 10,500 milliamp hour battery, and we're cruising at less than 5 amps, right around 5 amps. And that is running auto throttle, which is kind of bouncing around a little bit. So I think if you kind of tune that up a little bit better, which you probably will be able to do with an airspeed sensor, that's one of the reasons why you want it. You can get a little bit more stable throttle and stable airspeed. I think you could get that number down a little bit less, or more efficient rather. But anyway, theoretically, we should be able to get close to 2 hours in the air. But then again, that's a theoretical rating for that battery, 2,500. Like I said, it is just a standard 18650, a 4S3P. But they're the NCR 18650 GA cells. So more realistically, around 3,000 milliamp hours for one cell is about the most you really want to rely on. Maybe even slightly less than that. So I kind of treat this pack as roughly about a 9,000 milliamp hour battery. So more realistically, I would say we probably have about an hour and a half in the air with a little bit of reserve. So more than enough, put it like that. We've been flying, 15 minutes now? And I've already gone all the way to the river and back, and now I'm halfway to the river again. So, I mean, yeah, the airplane's capable of a lot more range than that, obviously. But I'm trying to zoom out on my map here, and I don't know how. There we go. There's how to reactivate that window. So, yeah, if I zoom out, that's my logged flight path, where we've been so far and where we're headed. We'll just leave it about there, I guess. Or maybe if I zoom in a little bit. I know there's a certain point where you zoom in, it goes from blurry to sharp. There we go. kind of reloads the map at a certain zoom level. Yeah, there's really nothing to complain about, obviously. Because everything's working extremely well. So back to the Dragonlink RSSI. Like I said, it's been staying in the low to mid 50s for the whole flight. That is to be expected with the firmware. I have the latest stable firmware on the Dragonlink. I think it's November 2020 is the date that it was released, if I remember right. But don't quote me on that. I know it's the latest stable firmware. It's not the next gen firmware. The next gen firmware should have that scaled a little bit more linearly versus distance. It's just something to be aware of. If you're used to the way some other LRSs, especially Crossfire, they show link quality rather than RSSI by default. If you saw in the low to mid 50s on Dragon, on Crossfire, you would be in trouble. Basically, your turnaround point is 70% link quality. But in my experience with Dragonlink, normally the older firmwares, and especially the 433 megahertz system, you have higher RSSI numbers. You know, it scales a little bit more linearly, but you always have control right down to zero. You know, you can be right down in the low single digits and still have a decent amount of control left. It might start get laggy a little bit. You'll feel it before you hit failsafe. But I just wanted to point out, when you see that 50% RSSI, I'm not running, you know, it's not a problem. It's just the way this particular firmware on the 915 megahertz Dragonlink system displays RSSI. But the reason I haven't moved up to the next gen firmware, which should have a lot of that stuff corrected and some more features, especially for using the relay link, using SBUS input to the Dragonlink from the FreeSky receiver. With the next gen firmware, it will actually detect an SBUS failsafe bit on its input, which it right now it doesn't, which you should never lose your 2.4 link. I mean, the receiver is sitting like 10 feet from me right now. But just for, you know, worst case scenario, just say the receiver should like die or burn up or your transmitter stop working or something like that, then the SBUS input from the 2.4 relay link into the Dragonlink, if that SBUS input goes down, then the Dragonlink just continues putting its last input. So just say right now, if my receiver died, my airplane would just keep flying away until it lost its signal, then the flight controller would take over and hit a failsafe. So in that event, the only way to get the airplane back would be for me to power down the Dragonlink and let the receiver go into failsafe. But if I had the SBUS bit was detected on its input, now I don't know if it will detect a loss of input and go into failsafe. You know, just say it, in that theoretical, hypothetical situation, just say if the receiver died and the input just stopped, I don't know what it'll do even with the next gen firmware. That's, like I said, the worst case scenario, then I could just reach up there and power down the Dragonlink and the receiver would take over and trigger failsafe. But if for some reason the failsafe bit gets set on the input with the next gen firmware, then the transmitter will trigger a failsafe on the receiver. I actually need to kind of test that, just satisfy my own curiosity. I'm just curious if the SBUS input just stops for some reason, just say, like I said, if the receivers just died. I'm not sure what it would do, actually. But that, and the main improvement with the next-gen firmware for the Dragonlink...
Battery at 80%.
We're down to 80% now. But the main improvement with the next-gen firmware for the Dragonlink is a better tolerance, especially on the 433 megahertz systems, a better tolerance for noisy flight controllers. I do have an F765 wing from Matic on my workbench that I've never got around to using, which I will eventually, just haven't yet. But it's known to be noisy on 433 megahertz, and it reduces your Dragonlink range. Now, even reduced range with that flight controller. People are reporting failsafes at like 10, 12 miles, something like that. But if you can alleviate the problem and get back to what, you know, 30, 40 mile range system, then why not do it, right? So they've actually done some pretty clever things with the firmware to make Dragonlink kind of skip around that noisy flight controller and work alongside it. So I'll probably want that. Now, like I said, I am running the 915 megahertz system right now in this particular airplane. But if I should end up with the F765 in an airplane with a 433 megahertz receiver, then I will definitely want the next gen firmware on it. But I'm kind of waiting until I need to, just to let the firmware mature a bit and get back to hopefully get into a stable release before I upgrade to it. But if not, I'll upgrade to the beta if I need to at that point. Yeah, let's go back to, actually, I want to do a loiter, which I believe I have flight mode 5 set to. Yeah.
Loiter flight mode.
I just want to let the airplane loiter for a little while out here and just kind of see how well it handles that. I want to see how well it holds its altitude and position and everything, just while I burn off some of this battery and wait for the darkness to set in. Because we've used, what, 2,100 milliamp hours out of, like I said, around 900 or so being realistic, 10.5 rated, so we still have a lot of battery left. We're definitely not going to be able to push the battery all the way to its limits. In fact, I remember the one time I tried to see how long this battery would fly for. I took off as soon as the winds calmed down enough for me to get in the air. I took off and I flew until it was basically any darker, it would have been too dark to land. So it's got enough, more than enough battery. I guess at this point, what, we've been going for 23 minutes now. My recording has been running for about the same 23 and a half minutes. I do think I'm going to fly back closer to home. I'm probably going to end the video here pretty soon. What I'm going to do, though, I'm going to fly back closer to home and then put it back into loiter mode like it is right now. And I'm going to walk outside with my other camera and try to get some footage from the ground of the airplane circling above. I'm just kind of curious how well my little strobe light shows up. I do have the little, I think it's the Strikes strobe light on the back. It's got a solid red light with a strobing white light. It's on the top of the wing, so any airplanes flying above me should be able to see it. As, you know, not that I really think I need it for safety or anything. I put it on the airplane because it looked cool and it fit well in the little GPS pocket, because I actually have my GPS sitting over one of the side pockets on the wing with a little open door, little open and close hatch thing. But I just had the little empty GPS bay up there, so I put the little strobe light up there. And like I said, my thinking behind that was that any aircraft flying above me where they should be able to see the airplane. My airplane, rather. So let me go ahead and go back to cruise mode, which is flight mode 3. I'm going to wait until it kind of, till the heading is back closer to where I want to be, and then I'm going to go back and loiter home, and I'm going to get to a lower altitude as well.
Cruise. Cruise flight mode.
So let's go ahead and lose some of this altitude. And you might notice when I switch modes here, I have two callouts. Because I have the special functions in OpenTX is set to call out the flight modes when I switch them, but Yahoo telemetry, now that I have that set up and working, also calls out the flight mode, so I'll probably disable my special function callouts and just let Yahoo handle that. That's why, if my microphone's picking that up, I'm not even sure if you can hear it or not, but if so, that's what the deal is with that. So now we should be leveling off just over 100 feet or so here, and I want to get a little bit closer to home. I want to loiter a waypoint right about here, so I want to go to flight mode 5. Now I'm going to let it loiter a little bit while I take the time to thank you all for watching the video, and of course all my Patreon pledges as well as channel members that support what I'm doing financially and make this all possible. And of course, I want to thank you for watching the video, and thumbs up, thumbs down. If you have any questions, comments, drop those down there below. Now, before we close out the video, though, don't click away just yet. Like I said, I'm going to run outside while it's slaughtering, and I'm going to record the airplane from the ground, and we'll close out with that. I'll probably go ahead and stick the landing in the end, but it's probably going to be the end of the narration. So, I will see you all in the next video, and enjoy the rest of this one. And there's the strobe light. Hopefully it's not too shaky. I'm having to zoom in pretty far. Pretty cool stuff.